In April 2020, NASA named Dynetics' human-rated moon lander design as one of three the U.S. Space Agency hopes to develop in order to send astronauts to the lunar surface as early as 2024. After only several months of work, on September 15th, Dynetics unveiled a full-scale model of its very unique lunar lander design, one that would almost be completely reusable save for a few drop tanks during its descent to the lunar surface. Today we'll take a look at Dynetics' lander design and how it fits into the overall Artemis program and how its mockup will help the company further iterate its lunar vehicle. But first, be sure to give this video a like and subscribe to the channel if you haven't already. Now let's get right into it. The three companies NASA selected back in April to build human landing systems for the Artemis program were Blue Origin, SpaceX, and of course Dynetics. They were awarded $579 million, $135 million, and $253 million respectively for a base period of about 10 months to refine their concepts. All three proposals will have to get astronauts from a near rectilinear halo orbit around the moon, where the Orion spacecraft and the Lunar Gateway will be stationed, to the surface of the moon and back. Which company NASA selects to proceed with the Artemis 3 mission, the first planned human landing in the 21st century, is expected to be decided in early 2021. While the wild card selection was SpaceX and its single-stage Starship-based lunar lander, the other two were somewhat more conventional. Blue Origin's lander is a three-stage concept that will be built by four main companies collectively called the National Team. Blue Origin will build the descent stage, Lockheed Martin is tapped to build the ascent vehicle, and Northrop Grumman will build a transfer element. A fourth company, Draper, would develop guidance and navigation and control, avionics, and software systems. Finally, there's the Dynetics spacecraft, internally called the Autonomous Logistics Platform for All Moon Cargo Access, or ALPACA for short. But publicly, they still call it the Dynetics Human Landing System, or DHLS. Regardless of its name, the vehicle is sort of a two-stage lander. Its design would see the main vehicle go from the halo orbit all the way to the surface of the moon and back. However, during its descent, it would have two strap-on tanks to augment the fuel before detaching shortly before landing. These drop tanks would not be reused, however, the rest of the system would. Dynetics' lander design team also encompasses more than 25 subcontractors for various elements and system-level components. One major selling feature of the lander is the position of the crew cabin relative to the lunar surface, only a few steps. Meanwhile, Blue Origin's lander would require a long ladder to climb down, and SpaceX's Starship would require an even longer elevator for an elevator ride down. To get the Dynetics lander to the staging halo orbit could be done in one launch via the Space Launch System. However, more likely it will need three smaller commercial vehicles, such as United Launch Alliance's Vulcan rocket, spaced out several weeks. Other than that, not a whole lot has been released about the design. However, during a video presentation on September 15th, Dynetics talked a little bit more about the vehicle's capabilities and what their new mockup hopes to help the team accomplish. Using their newly built low-fidelity test article in Huntsville, Alabama, the mockup gives engineers and astronauts a way to provide insight into how the lander will operate, where things will be located, as well as how to live and work aboard the vehicle. While it gives a general representation of the system, it's volumetrically accurate, and the equipment mockups inside give engineers and astronauts the ability to move systems around to figure out the best internal configuration for use. Early designs are already being evaluated using the mockup. The test article is also being used for human-in-the-loop testing analysis. Some of the questions being asked by the design team are, how much space does the crew need to eat, sleep, and live? How much space do astronauts need to do each of their tasks? Is everything easily accessible? Can the astronauts move in, out, and through the vehicle comfortably and safely? And so much more. Dynetics says their lander is sustainable in a number of ways. Once back in orbit around the moon, the spacecraft can be refueled and reused, only needing new drop tanks. According to Kim During, Vice President of Space Systems at Dynetics, early and ongoing reusability is key to the future of the human spaceflight program. Moreover, Dynetics is using flight-proven technologies for many of its systems, including the habitat, power, thermal, and other subsystems. Dynetics says their lander is also versatile. The crew module can be swapped out with cargo pods, lunar base modules, large pressurized rovers, or even an in-situ resource utilization demonstration plant for delivery to the surface of the moon. Kim During also said This will open opportunities for government and commercial entities to establish a lunar infrastructure and eventually a lunar economy. While not a whole lot is known about the specifications of the Dynetics lander, the company said it's similar in size to the Apollo lunar module of the 1960s and 70s. It also appears that the spacecraft's 8 main engines will use cryogenic liquid oxygen and liquid methane propellants, meaning that the storage of cryogenic fluids for long periods of time without boil-off will be a technical challenge, one which Dynetics has yet to disclose how it will tackle. As of the publication of this video, it's unclear whether the engines used will be a new design or something modified from off-the-shelf technology. Based on imagery, we can make a few safe assumptions, however. The main ship will stand about 4.5 meters tall, not counting the rollout solar arrays at the top, and will be about 9.5 meters wide. For comparison, the Apollo lunar module was 7 meters tall, and Blue Origin's lander is expected to be about 11 meters tall, while SpaceX's Starship is expected to be a whopping 50 meters tall. Once you add all the drop tanks to Dynetics' lander, it'll be a little bit longer than the 9.5 meters. Those drop tanks, however, as well as the rest of the thrust structure, is one area NASA said could pose the biggest schedule risk to the spacecraft's development. So what do you think about the Dynetics lander? Do you think NASA will ultimately choose this proposal to send astronauts to the surface of the moon during the Artemis 3 mission or other missions beyond? Or do you think Blue Origin and SpaceX will ultimately win out? Let me know in the comments below. Also, if I've earned it, it'd mean the world to me if you could subscribe to Orbital Velocity if you haven't already, and share this video and others with friends and family. It helps support the channel and also lets me know what topics you're all interested in regarding human space exploration. You can also follow Orbital Velocity on Twitter and Facebook. Additionally, you can visit orbital-velocity for even more space-related content, including a monthly newsletter called The Space Capsule. Links are in the description below. Thanks again for watching, and until next time, Ad Astra.